If you're gonna teach me force-free. Wow, Louise, I had to sing us in today because unfortunately we've got some technology problems and our force-free jingle's not working. So our force-free jingle has taken the day off. How are you?
I'm great, thanks, Nikki, and thank you so much for singing us in like that. That was absolutely amazing. What else can I say?
You're laughing at my lack of vocal ability. You're laughing at my lack of vocal ability, aren't you?
I thought it was absolutely amazing. That's all I'm going to say.
Well, thank you so much for the plus R on this. It's the first Sunday of the month. And because it's the first Sunday of the month and it's 12 noon Eastern time, this is PPG World Service, bringing you the best of our industry. So you are here to join us to chat, chuckle and share. And we have three great guests on today, and they're not, this is not the order they're going to appear. Angelica Steinker is here, Jennifer Shryock, and Janis Bradley. So who's on first, Lou?
Well, first of all, we've got Jennifer Shryock coming up, and she's going to be talking to us about the Family Pause Parent Education Program and lots of other things.
So let's get Jennifer on then. Jennifer, are you there?
I am indeed. Good morning, ladies.
Morning. Well, Jen, before we start, let me just do a little bit of an introduction here for you. Okay, so this is Jennifer Shryock, and Jennifer is a certified dog behavior consultant. She is the owner of Family Pause. She's also the founder of Dog Gone Safe, which is a nonprofit dedicated to bite prevention and victim support. She's a proud member and a special advisory council member at the Pet Professional Guild. So Jennifer's very invested in PPG. So Jen, thanks so much for being with us today. I'm not going to say too much more about Family Pause Parent Education because I know Louise has got some great questions for you. So I'm going to turn over to Louise and let's get this party started.
Excellent.
Hi, Jennifer. Welcome to the show.
Good morning.
Good morning. I've got lots of questions for you, so I'm going to go ahead and ask you the first one. And that is, what were some of the reasons behind setting up Family Pause Parent Education?
Back in when we first originally adopted our first German Shepherd, I became involved with German Shepherd Rescue. And as a volunteer, and I know many of you professionals have also volunteered with Rescue over the years, and if you've participated in answering voice phone lines, you may receive calls where people are looking to turn in their dog or have behavioral issues or concerns. One of the popular concerns that I would hear was, we're having a baby and we have this large dog and our family says we need to rehome it, we need to get rid of it because we can't have a baby and a German Shepherd in our home together. And all of that seemed very, you know, unfair to me. So in looking and doing a lot of research, I didn't see a lot of information about dogs and babies. There really wasn't all that much. I was having dogs and babies together and, you know, decided that we needed more information and education. So along with my certification in dog behavior consulting, I decided that that was an area I chose to specialize in, was dog and baby. And so 2002, we started Dogs and Storks from my living room.
Wow. So Family Pause is actually the parent is the parent organization of two licensed programs, isn't it? The Dogs and Storks, which you've just mentioned, and also the Dogs and Toddlers. Can you tell us a little bit more about both programs, please?
Absolutely. Dogs and Storks prepares families with dogs for life with baby. So that is actually really for families prior to, whether they're adopting a baby or they have, they're expecting a baby. And that one's really just preparation, and it's more about preparing the owners more than the dog, but really helping them to learn more about their dog, what to look for, observations, getting to know, communication. There's a lot of different things, so they come to our program thinking they're going to learn one thing and they really leave learning quite a bit more. The Dogs and Toddlers program, our tagline for that is preparing families with dogs for life with toddler. Ideally, we want to help and support families. We want it to be a continuation from the Dogs and Storks so that families continue learning as baby grows. We always say babies grow, dogs age. We need to adjust with every stage. It's continuous learning. And so that's what that program is geared towards. Once babies are about 3 months and up, we're going to have a lot more information to be offering our parents.
Okay, so what would you actually say is, I know there's so many things that people need to know, but what is the most important must-know information for expecting parents with dogs?
My newest priority, because I see this leading to so much heartache, is a need for comfortable separation within the home. The most common thing that I see families run into problems with, even more so than attention-seeking behaviors, is once when the baby is actually crawling and a parent needs to separate the dog a little bit while baby's crawling on the floor, they're not able to do so because the dog has never been separated while they're in the home. So maybe the dog's been in a crate, or while parents are out at work, the dog's been alone in the house, but no one's ever separated the dog and shown them how to be comfortable in the home while a parent's in another room. So management, different options of management, we refer to them as success stations. It helps that idea of separation and different options feel a little more comfortable for many families. But I really think that's one of the number one priorities that we need to work with families right away. I even before they're expecting a baby, I think every single puppy, every dog should learn to be comfortably separated, especially if we're in a home with multiple dogs. Because when you have a baby or child on the floor, it is a given that we're going to need to have some separation time. And it's ideal if the dog feels safe, comfortable, and actually enjoys that time.
Absolutely. Like you say, great advice for everybody, whether they're actually expecting a baby or not. Very good. Okay, what are some of the most common trouble spots between toddlers and dogs in a home? So once that baby has started crawling around, or maybe running around even, what are the most common trouble spots?
Again, this would go back to expectations, right? So I wouldn't even say that it's so much about the child or the dog, because they're doing what comes naturally. So I think it's where parents have a different expectation and an image in their mind of what should be happening, and that should is really kind of the kiss of death there. They imagine something and how things should look like and should be because of all the glorious pictures we see and the images we have, thanks to, you know, movies and, you know, good old social media and all those wonderful pictures that everybody wants to flaunt. And really, expectations are the main problem here. So we need to really help families to understand and recognize that dogs and babies don't need to necessarily be touching, to be cohabitating, to be in the same, to be in the environment together and enjoy each other with distance. Babies and dogs don't necessarily need to be in close proximity. Most dogs really don't like a toddler right up in their space. In fact, that's one of the leading problems that we have. So I think it's more about the adults having the proper expectations and us being able to offer that education to them consistently and having them receive it, finding ways to give them that. But the common trouble spot that I see is right around that 4 months when baby starts moving. Parents let their guard down because everything's gone great up for the first 3 months. But now it's a game change and no one's really, you know, the dog hasn't gotten the memo that this little being that's been in someone's arms or in equipment is now going to be on the move. And so that becomes really, really stressful for so many dogs. And that catches many people off guard. They don't understand. Why is they love the baby up until now? Well, that's, you know, so that often creates conflict. And we need to do better about providing education about that. And that's really what we're striving to do.
Absolutely. So some more great tips there. It is basically that, you know, the baby and the dog do not actually need to be in close proximity to each other. Great. Okay. Can you give us some insight into how changing family dynamics affect the pet dog?
That brings up a gazillion images. There's so many different types of dynamics. Change in dynamics always is going to be something that we need to have a heads up for our families that, for example, when they return home with the baby, if there are multiple dogs in the household, I always, always say to my families, listen, don't be surprised if your dogs have a little grumbly session between each other, even if they normally get along. That change of dynamics, change in routine, change in transitions, everything can rock the balance, rock that dynamic, so that you may have some problems. Because we all, listen, that happens in my own household. When my son comes home from college, our whole household is thrown off a little bit. School's starting for my family, and so as my son goes back to college or as my kids go back to school, all the humans have trouble, you know, going back to routines. So we can't expect, and we often do, that our dogs just roll with it. But when we change dynamics of any sort, whether it's adding a person, adding a dog, adding, you know, new furniture for crying out loud, we have to give our dogs credit that this is a change that may need a little, they may need a little extra support. So we have to really pay attention to that and respect it and be aware of that and not be caught off guard and not certainly not punish them for it. I think so many times families get very frustrated when their dog doesn't just roll with it. And we really need to help raise awareness that their dog's doing the best they can. And it's our job to help make them comfortable and help them to handle those situations and really to be there to support them through that kind of change in dynamic, no matter what it is, environmental or new people, that kind of thing. So I hope that sort of answers your question, but dynamics has a lot of categories in this with families. I'm thinking about a lot of things, especially visiting. A lot of families, when they bring home a baby, they have in-laws, they have families come visit, and they bring dogs too. You know, so all that can get really crazy. We have to be really mindful of how our dogs adapt to those situations.
I have to say, Jen, I have to butt in here a minute because I have to say, I mean, I have two dogs. One of them is 11 and one's 7. And, of course, we don't have children. I'm not sure if either of my dogs have ever actually met children because we live in a very rural environment on quite a large amount of land. But in about 3 weeks, my brother will be here for 2 days. He's coming over from the UK, and my house is about to have some little rugrats in it. And I'm already having palpitations about how I'm going to manage this because, I mean, children scare me anyway in any normal circumstance, but to then put them in an environment with dogs, what's the sort of quickest piece of advice that you could give me other than keep them all completely separate? What would you say to someone like me?
I would say that you have to keep in mind that short and sweet sessions where it's very structured is going to be the name of the game. Probably depending on your dogs, and you know your dog's personalities best, sometimes it's ideal to introduce and have them individually meet and do a little short and sweet exercise. If it's a small child, say a toddler, sometimes maybe I'll put them up on a chair or raise them up a little higher so they're not right in your dog's face, depending on the height of the child and the dog. Other times, you know, it just depends. I might put a gate there and let some games go on, like tossing treats over that gate, so that there's a definite barrier. If the barrier's not going to create stress or anxiety for the dog, again, you know your dogs. So looking at that. Other times, having both dogs together can be a comfort for the other dog, right? So if we have a nice structured activity and keep it short and sweet, that way it's a positive experience for everybody, and then give your dogs a break with something yummy, let them go have their downtime. But that's really, when I have visiting kids, that's really what we do, is short and sweet introductions, very structured, then let the good dogs have their downtime, and then maybe we'll have a structured game. But it's often hands off. If my dog chooses to seek attention and physical touch, that's going to be something different, but it's not a given. I think most guests come to our home and think they're going to put their hands on our dogs, you shouldn't assume this. And I think that's where a lot of our dogs go, you know, I don't like that. And I know many of the homes I go into with dogs, I never touch the dog. And that is something I would make very clear. Know your dog, talk to the kids, set the boundaries and rules, and you as the owner, like, set the boundaries and rules. I know you will, Nikki. But not all our families, not all our families feel comfortable doing that. We have
to really tell our families,
like, you need to set the boundary and be the advocate for your dog, seriously.
I have to be the advocate for myself when there's children around, let alone the dog. Don't make eye contact.
I think you might need your own little success station to go to.
It'll be the bar. That's where the success station for me will be.
Maybe you need a frozen margarita, you know, instead of a Pong, we'll get you something else. But it really is important that we do. There's social pressure, right? So you bring up a really great subject, and that's something that we do talk about a lot. The social pressure when family visits is so high for our families. I can't tell you, you mentioned dynamics before. I can't tell you how many family conflicts are brought up because of visitation and dogs and children. It's huge. It was a huge thing for my family. Because people don't want to be told. I know.
I'm on like a 3-week countdown already. It's like, oh my God, 3 weeks and they'll be here.
Just call me. I have certain things, and I've been known to create handouts for people that are specific that address things. So you can say the professional said it and I didn't.
I'm a huge believer in consent testing. So obviously, you know, everything will be on the dog's program. I was actually hoping maybe I should talk to you offline. Maybe you can give me some more advice on how to manage children.
Absolutely, yes. And we can.
The dogs are fine. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Good tag points for the kids and things like that. But there's lots of great ways that we can do that, and I love helping kids be successful too, because it's important that they are as well. Because when you think about it, the more that you're helping a child be successful with interaction with your own dog or other people's dogs, you're really doing a service for the other dogs in the community in general, right?
Yeah, so absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. Thank you for that.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to take the conversation away now from Kongs and frozen margaritas, and I'd like to ask you...
Oh, no, why? Why?
I'd like to ask you, Jennifer,
about... Nikki, you're licking your tongue. Yeah, no. I'm just kidding.
That's okay.
Children, no.
Oh, dear. Okay, Jennifer. You're a member of the Pet Professional Guild Special Council, aren't you? Can you tell me how important this role is to you?
I think it's really a wonderful role. The PPG offers so many tremendous resources, and I really, really love that this organization is supportive of dog safety and education and promoting that. That's very important to me. And I did want to just I used to be a vice president of Dog Unsafe. I'm not a founder, but certainly was very involved and was vice president and for the U.S. and I love everything to do with dog bite prevention, education, and that was something that meant so much to me, that PPG was one of the first organizations that really chose to make this part of their focus from the beginning. So that's really very important.
Okay, and going back to family paws parent education, what are the actual requirements for a professional to become a licensed family paws parent educator?
That's a great question. We have a process for people to go through. They need to first fill out the inquiry form. I love Google. It's a very good friend of mine. We can usually do a lot of research online. I do an over the phone interview with people. If they're international, we Skype. Word of mouth, I do contact other professionals in the area. I do reference the Pet Professional Guild directory to see if there are other people who know those who've applied. We're always cross-checking resources, and that's very important to me. All of our professionals come to us with very good background, whether it's in dog behavior, dog training, or also come with other experience, which is really exciting too. Many are have education backgrounds, lots of psychology backgrounds, so we have a wide range of professionals within Family Paws, which is something that I really appreciate, especially because we deal so strongly with families. Lots of teachers within our program. They are required to take our 13 final exam. That's 23 short answers. It's a pretty extensive final that they do, and we're really proud of our foundation course and the beginning licensed presenter program.
Thank you for that. I just thought it was a question worth asking because I know there are probably a lot of professionals out there who would be interested mm-hmm. in doing the program.
Yeah, and obviously we are
I'd like to go
for, we are looking for professionals that are course free. That is also a requirement of ours. It is essential that, you know, we believe so strongly, we know that in homes with children, that is a key factor, and anything that we're going to be doing in front of children with our dogs has to be dog and child friendly, so it's very important to us.
Awesome. So I obviously totally agree with you about that. Force free is definitely the way to go. I happen to know as well that you're doing a lecture at the PPG's annual course for educational summit in Tampa, Florida, entitled Are You Cognizant of the Grumble Zone? Can you give us some information about your presentation, please, Jennifer?
Well, I unfortunately, due to some medical issues that I'm having this year, sadly am not going to be able to attend, but would love to do maybe a webinar on the same topic. The Grumble Zone and Growl Zones are really important topics, and I'm really sad that I'm not going to be able to come in person for that, but it is a really important topic that I would like to share with everybody. Because it is part of what is such an important, it's huge when it comes to dogs like the toddlers and newly crawling babies. And it's one of those things that we really have focused a lot on with our dogs and toddlers program. So maybe that's something that Nikki and I can set up. But yeah, it's
absolutely.
Kind of been
absolutely.
An unfortunate decision that I had to make. And
absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay, well, thank you so much. I'm so sorry you're not going to be at the summit, but a webinar sounds absolutely amazing. Before you go, Jennifer, can I ask, how can people get in touch with you and find out more about all the different programs?
Sure. We can be easily reached at familypaws.com. I encourage people really to look at some of our videos. We have a lot of resources there that are free for professionals to offer to their the families that they're supporting. I can be reached at jen@familypaws.com. And I'm more than happy and very accessible, I think most people would agree, for anybody, whether you're a Family Paws presenter or not. If you've got a dog and baby, dog and toddler case situation, always feel free to reach out to me. It's my passion. I'm here for you. I'm here. These cases are not always as easy as we'd like to believe, and I really want to be here to support others as well. We've got a solid team and like to be available. So jen@familypaws.com. And we have a new course coming up starting in September.
Wonderful. Thank you, Jen. Thanks for being
Wonderful.
Here.
Thank you, Jen. Thanks for being here. Thank you.
Okay, Nikki, I've got a few questions for you now.
Okay, let's go.
So, Is that okay? Right. My first question is all to do with the PPAB accreditation program. I've seen a few comments about different accreditation programs, qualifications. Can you tell me how does PPAB's accreditation program differ from other programs and qualifications that may be out there? What makes it stand out?
Well, I think other than the CCPDT, I think we're the only psychometrically developed certification program. So what does that mean? It means that we worked with an examination company that specializes in psychometric testing. And what does that mean? It means that the test is applicable to what industry experts believe are the necessary skills, knowledge, and talent that you need to be able to operate in our industry at a high level of competency. And I think the other key component is that anyone who wants to apply for this, and doesn't have to be PPG members only, you are held to a high level of transparency and accountability and competency. So there are eligibility requirements. It's not just about popping your money on the table. You have to believe in force-free training. We believe there's no place for shock, chunk, proke, fear, or intimidation. So there is an eligibility application. You have to show that you have a certain number of years in the industry, that you have insurance, that you use, operate, and live within these principles. You sign off on that so that in the future, if it's determined that you are not, the accreditation is revoked. So that's one of the big differences. There are, as we know, lots and lots of certification programs out there. And I'm just going to go over really quickly the pathway to accreditation, because there are two accredited programs. There is the Professional Canine Behavior Consultant accredited and the Professional Canine Trainer accredited. And they both have slightly different pathways as to how you reach that. So the first thing is you have to submit an eligibility application. And there is a $45 fee for that. And then we check that you meet that criteria. And then once that's done, then you submit your full application. And then the examination company contacts you. The other great thing about our examination is that it can be done from your home using a webcam. So you are monitored and proctored through the exam, but it's by webcam. And then for the canine trainer, after you have passed the exam, that's your first gatekeeper, then you have to submit 10 skill videos. And there's a very objective criteria for those as well, which they're sort of independently assessed based on an objective criteria. So once that's done, then you become a PCTA. Now, if you're looking to become the Professional Canine Behavior Consultant, then you have to submit four case studies. And these are extremely objective. There is a template that's used, so nobody is determining whether you are competent based on their individual opinion. There are key criteria that have to be hit during that process. So that's the total process. So it covers everything from academic knowledge to mechanical skills, and then your ability to actually functionally analyze behavior, which is really important. And you know, the whole reason for PPAB was because we wanted to have a professional accreditation that didn't just look at and evaluate based on skills, but also based on consumer transparency and professional accountability. And we think that one of the big things lacking in our industry is that from a consumer perspective, you know, other than a couple of websites, how do you find a professional and really know what they are going to provide to you, how they are going to treat you, what philosophies they're going to bring to the table, what methodologies they're going to recommend you use? So consumer transparency, consumer awareness and protection is that anyone carrying this accreditation has specifically said, signed off on, and is being held accountable to a certain set of standards. And then professional accountability, that there is an ethics committee that oversees this. And if, you know, a member, if there's a complaint because somebody who's accredited is using, you know, a piece of equipment that is not approved, or you know, they are employing tactics or methods that don't fit within the principles, then that accreditation can be revoked. So we have a very powerful way of maintaining and managing the database of credentialed trainers and behavior consultants to make sure that they really are great ambassadors for the program. So psychometrically sound you know, a lot of other associations and organizations have their own programs, but they haven't, you know, we've invested a lot of money in this program, and it took probably 7 to 9 people, more than 18 months, almost 2 years to develop it. It was a lot of work. So we're really proud of the program, and we're really excited that people are excited about it too. So yeah, it's just good all around.
And how can people find out more, Nikki? Where can they go if they want to find out more?
Well, if they go to credentialingboard.com, they will find the website there. And on the website, they'll see information about the two programs, about what makes us different, the eligibility information, then the application. So lots of information. And if there's any questions or anyone has, you know, anything that they're not really understanding, if they email us, we respond very quickly to emails. And once somebody has actually applied and they are in the eligibility environment, then at that point they have access to a lot of back of house tools as well. There's a great study guide on the website which covers all the areas that the examination covers. So there's lots of tools there to help people prepare to actually take the tests and do the videos and the case studies. So credentialingboard.com.
Thank you very much for that, Nikki. And I'm going to change the subject just ever so slightly. I'd like to talk to you now a little bit about the upcoming summit that's November 11th to the 13th in Tampa, Florida. Can you give us a little bit more info, for example, how people register, who a few of the presenters are, et cetera, et cetera?
Absolutely, I will. This has probably been the most scary thing that I have personally been involved in with PPG, just because potentially it was really important for us, and it sort of sets us apart as being a real, real association, but also a lot of money at risk as well, you know, because we had to sign contracts and make commitments to the places that we are using for the summit. So the summit's in Tampa, Florida. It's November 11, 12, and 13 this year. We are using the Sheraton Hotel, and we also have two rooms at the convention center, which you can actually see on the screen. So just fantastic facilities. You know, we decided what we were going to do was actually package things to make it really easy. So we had a Mastiff package that covered your rooms, your meals, and all the presentations. And we had an Aussie package that covered just meals and the summit presentation. Then we had the Pug package that was just the actual presenter schedule, so people could then independently stay wherever they want. I have to tell you, it has been a huge success. I mean, the Mastiff package sold out really quickly. We were offering financing to members over 10, 11 months, and we had to actually negotiate with the hotel next door to open more. They have almost sold out. I think there's only one place left on that. The Aussie package has also been extremely popular. I think we only have about 27 more places left. And that's not because we're only capping it because we obviously need to make sure that we have enough room in the rooms. The lunches and breakfasts are going to be served around the pool. So we need to make sure that we don't oversell, that everybody can comfortably sit and have breakfast and lunch and then attend our splash dinner. So just it's been a lot of hard work. Next time is going to be a lot easier because obviously we have the templates now. Everything's been done. We had a great team of people that came on board almost a year ago to help us begin working on this program. And they're still there. We meet twice a month. So, you know, kudos to all those folks who've been there from the beginning. We've got some nice sponsors coming on board, and we just have, I mean, I think personally, and obviously I'm a little bit biased, but I think when you look at the presenters that we have, I think 31 or 32 presenters. I think we have the best presenters of any summit or convention this year. That's my personal opinion. I think it's objective, but, you know, Dr. Karen Overall is flying in to open it for us. She's doing a 4-hour session on day one. We have Dr. Michelle Duda, Janis Bradley, Ken McCourt, Laura Joseph, Jacqueline Manera, Nancy Tucker, Deborah Mulliken, Diane Garrard, Linda Michaels, Maureen Backman, Lisa and Brad Wagner, Diane Nichols-Papert, Pat Miller, Emily Lalem, Teresa McEwen, Pamela Johnson, Barb Levinson, Angelica Steinker, Chirag Patel, Shari Sprague. I mean, the list just goes on and on. I mean, wow, what an absolutely fantastic lineup of people. I mean, so exciting. And I'm actually starting to feel a little bit begrudgingly about the whole thing because I know it's going to be crazy for myself and the steering committee and the volunteers. So I'm going to be walking around resource guarding any spare time I can get to actually pop in and see some of these presentations. So if I'm sitting in a room there, if anybody so much as talks to me, they're going to get growled at. So it's just, I think it's just going to be absolutely tremendous. Really, really super, super, super excited. You can go to forcefreesummit.com to sign up if you want to grab one of those last few places. It is being fully recorded, so there will be DVDs on sale afterwards, but I don't think there's anything quite like being there in person. And I am personally so excited to meet our wonderful members that I've had contact with over the last 4 years through email and telephone and Facebook. It's going to be so nice to actually put faces to the names and to actually meet people that I feel like I know so well. I mean, there's some of our members that I actually would call friends now. I know them so well now. It's going to be great to sort of have some networking opportunities. So it's going to be fabulous. Really, really, really excited. Really excited. Super, super, super excited.
Great stuff. I've got to admit, I'm really looking forward to it too. And it'll actually be the first time that you and I meet up, Nikki.
I know, I know. I'm actually thinking of wearing some kind of disguise for the first few hours, just to, I might come dressed as, I don't know, Jean Donaldson or somebody who's not going to be there, just to have some fun. Yeah, it's going to be great. I mean, you're a good example, Louise, as someone that, you know, I would call a friend now. I've got to know over the last couple of years, and, you know, it's going to be so nice to actually go, whoa, that's what you look like. Your picture doesn't do you any credit at all, or... Yeah, it's going to be fun. And I think you can tell from my voice that I'm pretty excited. I'm actually going down there next Tuesday to the two hotels to finalize the room layouts and the dinner plans and the evening entertainment. So I think once I've done that, then it's really going to sink in that this is only, what, I don't know, 12, 14 weeks away. So, yeah, it's coming up.
Absolutely, and I can't wait. That photo that I'm viewing now on my screen is like, wow, yeah, can't wait to be there.
Yeah.
And that leads quite nicely, actually, into our next interview, because Janis Bradley, who we've now got on the show, is also actually going to be at the summit. So if you're there, Janis, I'd like to start asking you a few questions.
Hi, Janis. Welcome to the show.
I'm excited. Thank you very much.
So,
Janis.
Hi, Louise.
I'm going to do a quick intro, Lou, if that's okay. I'm just going to
How are you today?
I'm just fine. I'm very happy to be here this morning. It's morning here
Absolutely.
In California.
Let me just jump in and do the introduction.
Good. And over to you, Nikki.
Yeah, I'm just going to jump in and do the introduction that Janis deserves. So Janis is the Director of Communications and Publications of, well, we're going to talk about the organization in just a minute, but Janis has written books, she's done seminars, she's been responsible for certifying and training a lot of force-free trainers. So, I mean, I know Janis from the book Dogs Bite But Balloons and Slippers Are More Dangerous. I remember reading that a few years ago and just absolutely loving it. So Janis, really excited to have you come to the summit. I mean, I'm can't tell you how excited we are about that, and obviously to have you on today. So you're calling from Oakland, California, are you not? Are you still in California, or are you on the line from California?
I'm actually in Southern California now, in a town called Camarillo near Santa Barbara.
Okay. So I think everybody in Florida has been desperate to send you some of the rain that we've been having for the last 4 weeks. It's rained nonstop here. I know you guys badly need the rain over there. So yeah. I wish I could send you some from my pool that is pretty much overflowing every day.
We could certainly use it.
So, Lou, over to you.
Thank you, Nikki. Okay, Janis. Now, you are the Associate Director of Communications and Publications for National Canine Research Council. Can you tell us a little bit about your role, please?
I am. I'm actually the director now. My predecessor retired, so I'm in the directorship role, which probably can be best described as the head science geek.
Congratulations.
At National Research Council.
Congratulations.
Thank you. My primary work is really keeping up with all of the research that is We just have an overwhelming amount of it being produced now on how we as pet parents can communicate with, how we get along with, how we benefit from our relationships with the dogs that we bring into our homes. And then to take that research and make it accessible, make it useful as widely as possible. Particularly when things come up that can get in the way of those relationships being healthy and successful. one of the things that struck me when Jen was talking earlier was her talking about you pet parents as being the protectors for their dogs, the safe place for them. We now, for example, have research, and this is a common paradigm that's talked about in the people who study behavior and dog cognition. They talk about the effect of the owner as a safe haven for the dog and how that influences behavior. Probably one of the most positive things we can do is to become more and more mindful of that role in the relationship, of our role as a safe haven for our dogs. If we're mindful of that, a whole lot of problems that could crop up may never occur. Now, my communication work can include anything from developing educational materials and talking to media about educational materials for police officers that help them understand dog body language so they can recognize whether a dog sees them as a threat so that they can make choices about how to interact with that dog safely without doing harm. Can range from things like that to working directly with researchers on research projects to help understand how people can do their very best to form strong emotional bonds with their dogs. Or I might simply be writing blogs or writing policy papers about the various discoveries in these very complicated emotional lives of dogs and the emotional connections between dogs and people. So the short version is I'm the science geek.
Love it. And congratulations again. I'd just like to add that. I know Nikki said congratulations, but Director of Communications, so I apologize for introducing you as the Associate Director. It is Director.
Thank you. Not a problem.
So congratulations there. Okay, so you just mentioned that you conduct research on lots of different things, contemporary issues that impact the human-canine bond, the dynamics of popular attitudes towards dogs and canine aggression, lots and lots of things. One of the things you also conduct research on is media reporting on dogs. Can you tell me, how does the way the media reports on dog bite incidents impact public perceptions, and more importantly, public policies and legislation?
Oh, that's definitely a significant piece of my role, to try and explain and publicize how all the research that we have shows that there's nothing remotely resembling an epidemic of dog bites going on. Especially since, by its very nature, media reporting tends to give this impression. Whether the reporters intend to or not. And this is because events become newsworthy precisely because they are rare. Mundane things don't get reported on. So a serious dog bite incident, for example, gets far more coverage than a truly horrific car accident because car accidents are so common, so they're seldom newsworthy unless there's something in particular remarkable about them. But as news consumers, we're the news consumers. When we hear something repeated over and over and over again, and often serious dog bite incidents get coverage with multiple stories, the way our brains process this is as if it were happening over and over and over again, rather than hearing about the same incident multiple times. And so we kind of begin to feel as if there was a dog hiding behind every bush, just waiting to bite us, even though nothing could be farther from the truth. We're beginning to see some evidence, though. We've actually got a study in the works currently that this effect may actually be less pronounced among ordinary people, ordinary news consumers, and maybe more pronounced among policymakers, who often have a kind of something has to be done response to a single very serious incident. And so a big part of our role is to try and help diffuse some of that response, because Most policymakers agree that it's seldom very effective to try and legislate in response to a single very rare event. And yet this happens over and over again because of the extreme coverage of those events. So a big part of our role is to help policymakers look at what's really the case in terms of incidents and what are likely to be appropriate intervention to do things like reduce numbers of dog bites.
So do you think actually in some instances politicians are using the instance of dog bites, the publicity that surrounds them, almost as a publicity medium for themselves?
I don't know. I try and avoid getting into other people's heads and attributing motives to them, you know, when I don't know as much as possible. But I mean, it's certainly possible that that could be the case, that a given policymaker could see this as a kind of a, you know, platform to raise his or her profile. I can't say that I know that this is the case, though.
Yeah, interesting though. Okay. Let's go on from that. In the conclusion to your policy paper, Dog Bites, Problems and Solutions, it states, during a period where people increasingly consider and treat their dogs as family members, injurious bites have actually gradually declined, including a decrease in the percentage of injuries sustained by children. Current behavioral studies offer possible insight into why this is so, documenting the profound differences in the behavior of family dogs and resident dogs. First of all, can you explain the difference between a family dog and a resident dog? And then tell us how public policies that educate people about these relationships can help promote safer and more humane communities?
Certainly. This is an area of major discovery, because intuitively you would think that as we bring dogs into our homes and live more and more closely with them, which has certainly been the trend over the last few decades, that we'd have more exposure and therefore there would be more dog bites. This doesn't seem to be the case. And this concept of a family dog versus a resident dog may very well be part of the explanation for that. A family dog, in the way that we use this term, in the way that increasingly those who study dog cognition use the term, is a dog that actually lives as a member of a human family, meaning that they live closely, the dog lives closely with people, has daily opportunities for positive interactions with people, learns how to communicate with people. A resident dog, on the other hand, is just that. This is a dog that's simply resident on the property, doesn't have much interaction with people that would allow him to learn how to communicate, how to respond appropriately to human behavior. Sometimes the only contact a dog like this has with people are contacts that teach him to fear people. So these might be dogs that are kept outside in kennels or in chains or in a yard, but they can even live inside the home, isolated in a separate room or kept in a crate all the time, locked in basements. These are all resident dogs. The effects of this difference in living situations has been studied by dog behavior researchers. And this research shows that family dogs and resident dogs think and behave profoundly differently. And the reports are overwhelming that family dogs are perceived by their guardians as more friendly, as having many more positive qualities, as being more easy to train and responsive, none of this really should be surprising, than the reports from people who keep dogs who meet the resident dog definition. If you look at the far end of the research on dog behavior, the very, you know, end of the dark side, the people who study the very worst events, which are dog bite-related fatalities, these very, very rare events, what these researchers find is that the dogs involved in these dog bite-related fatalities are almost never family dogs. Even if the media reports may describe the dog as a family dog, if you dig a bit deeper into the case study, and we have a very good research study that's now done this exhaustively over a large number of cases, they are almost always resident dogs. They're dogs that have never had an opportunity to learn how to live with people safely, to behave appropriately around people. Although, of course, it's definitely important to note that there are millions and millions of resident dogs who still manage to live their lives out without ever harming a person. But it's certainly a risk factor. So any kind of public policy that encourages people, that helps provide them with resources, that help them incorporate their dogs as fully as they can into their daily lives, makes our communities safer, makes our communities more humane. It allows the dogs to do what they do best, what they're genetically prepared to do, which is form loving bonds with the people that they live with, and to see people in general in a positive way. Dogs are pre-programmed to look at people in this way. We just need to open the door and let them.
Fabulous.
Thank you, Janice. Very well said there. Yeah, yeah. I think that's a really big point. And I personally, I feel extremely sad when I see these dogs chained up outside and not interacting with their family. And to know that it has, well, it's such an impact on the dog, but also have an impact on, you know, passers-by, etc. I just think something needs to be done about this. Anyway, going on from that, in the National Canine Research Council and Series publication, The Relevance of Breed in Selecting a Companion Dog, you discuss whether breed is a useful indicator of the suitability of a companion dog. Do you think that a dog's breed can in any way predict their future behavior? And if not, how should people go about choosing a family dog?
It would certainly be a great convenience if it were a good predictor. It would you know, help inform a lot of our choices more easily. Unfortunately, from everything that we know so far, breed in general is just a very poor predictor of any individual dog's behavior. And after all, and for all practical purposes, in the real world, what we care about is how this particular dog is going to act. Nobody is really interested in their daily lives in dogs in the aggregate. Breed never really was an extremely good predictor, but it's even less so since about the end of the 19th century, when purebred dogs began to be selected almost entirely for appearance. So those are the selection criteria. And for more than half of the dogs in the United States that are actually mixed breeds, they have more than one breed in their ancestry, breed ancestry is completely irrelevant. That's because as soon as you have more than one breed in the dog's background, all of that dog's characteristics, genetically speaking, become just kind of a game of 52-card pickup. You've just thrown a bunch of genes up in the air, and where they land is where they land. You've got something that is well and truly randomized as soon as you have a mixed breed dog. Now, I'm gonna talk a little bit as if I were talking, I think, directly to pet parents, even though I know most of you are trainers. The most important thing to understand is that there's just no substitute for simply looking at the dog in front of you and then deciding on what you see whether or not that dog relates to you in the way that you want to live with the dog. And that's going to vary from person to person. If you can get a sense of the dog's energy level, for example, that's one of the most common variables in people's preferences. So while I may be looking for a couch potato, you may want a jogging partner. The same dog is not going to be appropriate. The only way to tell is to get to know the dog at least a little bit. If you're really lucky, you may have access to information about the dog's behavior and her likes and dislikes in an earlier home, which can be useful if you plan to provide a very similar environment. And that's an important caveat, by the way, because it's true that prior behavior is the best predictor of future behavior, but only in a similar environment. So you can't say that a dog that comes from an abusive environment, for example, and responds by trying to drive people away, will respond in that same way in another kind of environment. I happen to live with rescue greyhounds, for example, who come from spectacularly socially impoverished environments. You can't really tell very much about who they are when they come right out of that environment. But the good news is that dog behavior is so plastic and dogs are so prepared to bond with people that almost all of those dogs become unrecognizable from any other normal family pet in a few weeks' time in a normal human household. Okay, so the question of prediction of behavior may be less urgent than we feel that it is. But most of us, when it comes right down to it, and I'll bet that's true even of the trainers who are listening here, most of us choose our dogs because their looks appeal to us. Or sometimes they're just circumstances that arise that bring a particular dog to us at a particular time. There's nothing wrong with this. There's nothing wrong with it. I have greyhounds because their looks appeal to me. I've had different dogs of different appearances at different times in my life. But people, I know lots of people who identify themselves as greyhound people. And they're very inclined to tell me in sort of hushed tones that they're not like other dogs. Or they'll even say, there are several breeds where people say this, they're more like cats than dogs. This is just silly. I've had dozens of foster greyhounds through my house, and the one thing I can tell you for sure is that they seem like dogs to me. They have the usual range of personality traits. Everyone is an individual. But if you fill in a breed name here, everybody does this. As dog professionals, we really need to stop doing this because it sets up unrealistic expectations, both positive and negative. And it prompts pet guardians to opt out of taking responsibility for their effect on their dog's behavior if we lead them to believe that the dog's personality is somehow pre-programmed by breed. It's not a helpful paradigm for explaining behavior. The good news is, of course, that dogs as a species are extremely good at bonding with human beings, and they're really, really good at figuring out how to live with us, even if we're not consciously, mindfully training them. We're both, to tell you the truth, both humans and canines are kind of love the one you're with kinds of species. So if we can just prompt people to do things that help them bond with a new dog, to play with the dog, we've got some research showing that playing with dogs and petting them and just hanging out with them helps facilitate forming the bond from the human side, and paying attention to how the dog responds to things so that the pet parent can be that safe haven for the dog, can be sensitive to when the dog is uncomfortable and be that safe haven. In the vast majority of cases, even when that dog exhibits some behaviors that some people consider to be problems, these may well just become quirks to that dog owner and part of what makes her special to them. If you think about your own experience as a practitioner, if you work behavior cases, I'm sure you've had the kinds of experiences that I had many times when I had an active practice where I would go to see one client who was complaining about one particular behavior that was really putting that relationship in jeopardy. I would go through how to help that client work with that behavior, go on, get in my car, go on to the next client who had a dog exhibiting exactly the same behavior as the previous client's dog, and that client couldn't care less about that behavior. It was something else that bothered them. Behavior problems are in the eye of the, are to a very great extent in the eye of the human beholder. And the biggest, the best inoculation against that perception is forming a solid bond with that dog. Breed probably isn't the way to get at that. I hope that wasn't too meandering a response. This is a fairly passionate area for me.
It was an absolutely brilliant response, Janice. And so I think what it comes down to really is that just like people, all dogs are individual. And just because somebody or a dog looks a certain way, it doesn't mean they're going to act a certain way. Would that sum it up? Yeah. All right. Thank you. Right. I'm aware, Janice, that you need to go. So I'm going to quickly ask you a last question. Before we started speaking to each other, he was telling us all about Tampa, Florida. I happen to know that you're presenting on three topics at the summit. We've got That's the Lab in Him. We've got Putting Aggression in Context. A growl is not a slippery slope to assault. We've got We May Not Be the Rocket Scientist, but We Can Be the Engineers, Next Scientific Revolution in Dog Sniffing. So, as I said, I'm aware that we're running out of time, but can you give me a quick overview of these topics, your presentations, please?
Certainly. I'm really, really excited about this. Looking forward to the summit very much. The first presentation, the That's the Lab in Him, is really the scientific background and a lot more information on the point that we just talked about in breeds and predicting behavior. So as I just described, the conventional wisdom about breeds can lead us to biased perceptions, can lead us to unrealistic expectations, and this can be a disservice to clients. So I'm going to talk more about how tenuous the links really are between breeds and both specific behaviors and general personality traits, and how even when we can predict behavioral trait a little bit more, these things, the ones we can predict, are mainly confined to things like predatory action patterns that don't have much to do with the kinds of qualities that parents care about in their dogs anyway. In the Putting Aggression in Context, a growl is not a slippery slope to assault. This is, again, an area that is very, very near and dear to my heart, because I want people to understand that growling, snarling, snapping kinds of behaviors are more common than not. Probably at least one in two dogs does this at some time. This is garden variety, ordinary, common, mundane behavior. Only at the very most, one in 250 dogs delivers a bite that actually hurts somebody. It's time that we understand and realize the significance of this difference, of this dichotomy, of this difference, so that we can focus on factors that may be predictive of actual injurious bites inflicted by dogs, as opposed to normal expressions of conflict behavior. We're never going to make much progress on this issue if we continue to look at any expression of conflict on the part of a dog as a slippery slope to maiming a human being. It just isn't so. And so that particular presentation is going to go much more into the detail and the implications of that. The third one was one that I think Angelica or Nikki suggested to me as a possible topic, not framed in this way. And I thought about it a little bit, and I've gotten very, very excited about it. This is the one that the one that's titled "We May Not Be the Rocket Scientists, But We Can Be the Engineers: The Next Scientific Revolution in Dog Training." I was asked if I could come up with something about what I saw as the future right now of dog training. And I realized I have a very sort of strong inclination on this, based partly on my history, because I was part of the, I've been in dog training for quite a while now, and so I was part of the last big sea change in dog training, which was that group of scientifically minded trainers who took a profession that was really kind of folklore driven and said, where's the science here that we can apply to improving this profession of dog training? And they looked to the very large accumulation of science in the area of learning theory and really revolutionized this profession, I think, and have now turned it into the norm to use these principles of learning theory to make the world better for pet dogs. I think the next big thing is for dog trainers to figure out how to use this just explosion of discoveries in canine cognition and ethology. The stuff that the ethologists, the psychologists, the evolutionary biologists are doing in looking at relationships between dogs and their human companions, their human caregivers, looking at how those relationships work and how they work well, and finding what we can exploit in what people are already intuitively doing well to improve those relationships even farther. I think the scientists have done a big piece of their work, and now it's up to the trainers to say, how can we take all of this exciting new knowledge and apply it to go to the next step in making the world better for dogs and people? It's a very exciting time.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Janice. I'm personally looking forward to meeting you in Tampa in November, and I'm certainly looking forward to your presentations. And we'd love to have you come do some webinars for PPG as well. So thank you so much for that. Before we let you go, because I know that you're super busy and you have somewhere to fly to, how can people get hold of you all, or how can they get to the organization so that they can get more information?
The easiest way to get to the organization is just via our website. And that's National Canine Research Council, bit of a mouthful, .com. But you can reach me directly there at jbradley@ncrcouncil.com.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Janice, and we look forward to having you back on the show in the near future.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, before we bring my friend and colleague and business partner on, who's only about 6 miles down the road from where I am right now, I'm just going to put Angie on hold for a couple of minutes. This is the part of the show where we always talk about one of the PPG preferred vendors. And today we're going to talk about Doggone Safe. Doggone Safe, as Jennifer was saying, Doggone Safe and Family Paws have been supporters of PPG from day one. Doggone Safe offered a great discount on their membership program. So let's talk about Doggone Safe. Doggone Safe is a US-based 501c3 nonprofit with over 1,400 members in more than 30 countries. And the goal is to educate children, families, and dog owners about dog bite language, safety, safe handling methods, and how we should act safely around dogs. It seems to be a common theme to PPG World Service today. Their flagship bite prevention program is called Be a Tree, and the Be a Tree program has been delivered to nearly 1 million children worldwide. So Doggone Safe also has a dog bite victim advocacy program and group, dog bite victim support. So if you're interested, PPG members get a discount from joining Doggone Safe. So help teach others to speak dog. And there's several ways you can do that. You can join as a member. You can become a licensed Be a Tree presenter, which is a fantastic program, has some great tools and resources to help you get out into your community and educate, educate, educate. I think it's also a fantastic marketing tool as well for your businesses. So you can visit doggonesafe.com. As Jennifer mentioned, or I think she may have mentioned, Doggone Safe has recently come under a new board of directors, and I am very proud to announce that I was elected the president. So as of August 1st, I became the president for Doggone Safe. We have a great board of directors. I think there's 8 or 9 people. We're going to be announcing those in the next few days. So I know that Joan, Teresa, Jen, and Kerry will continue their great support of Doggone Safe. We look forward to working with them in the future. So again, if you're interested in dog bite safety prevention programs, go to doggonesafe.com. So without further ado, let's introduce Angelica. I'm not going to read off the screen. Angelica is a PPG steering committee member. She's been on board right from day one. Angie was the first person I approached when we first started PPG. She's also my fellow co-founder of Dognostics Career College, and she's also part of the Dogsmith. We're sort of intertwined at all angles. Angie is a fantastic trainer. She's published. She has a couple of books out in the marketplace. Rumor has it she's working on another one. Rumor doesn't have it. I've just made that a public announcement. She's actually working on another book. I'd probably be in trouble for saying that, but there you go. Angie, welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Wow, you can tell you're only 6 miles down the road. The quality of the audio is brilliant. So how are you?
I'm doing great. I'm enjoying being part of this terrific program and listening to Janice Bradley and Jennifer Shryock with awesome information. This is really a very valuable program and an amazing service you guys are providing.
Thank you, thank you, thank you. Well, we as through PPG. So Angelica's going to talk about something in particular today. She's going to talk about an article that was put into Barks. But I want to talk about, because I'm very familiar with Angie and a lot of the material that she's working on, because we are business partners in several different ventures. One thing that you'll learn about Angie as you get to know her is that Angie is all about fun. Everything she does is absolutely massive fun. And I think some of that will come through when we ask her some questions in just a minute about the article. We posted on Facebook a few days ago the title was Why Counter Conditioning Doesn't Work. And it started quite a nice debate. And obviously Angie's not saying counter conditioning doesn't work. She's saying if it doesn't work, this is what you have to look at, because it does work. It's brilliant. It's fantastic. It works massively for reactive dogs or any dogs that you're having problematic conditioned emotional responses with. So Angie, let's go. I mean, Lou, let's bring you into it. Sorry, this has sort of turned out into a friend fest here between Angie and I. So I'm gonna bring Lou into this. Lou, I know you've got some great questions for Angie, and I'll probably butt my head in at some point. So how are we starting this? Let's get this interrogation started.
Absolutely. Thanks, Nikki.
You're on the spot.
Thank you. And you're right, the title actually did cause a little bit of controversy, because the title was Why Counter Conditioning Does Not Work. But actually in the article, Angie, you state that when counter conditioning is ineffective in a behavior modification program, a lack of competence on part of the trainer is almost always the cause. I'm going to ask you a question there though. Can there be other reasons that are beyond the trainer's control?
Absolutely, and this is one of my favorite topics. Thanks so much for asking that question. Many variables can come into play, really as many as you could think of. There are dogs that are outliers, that are unusual, and what's certainly not unusual are medical problems. Many dogs are engaging in certain behaviors because they have a medical condition that's underlying, and this medical condition needs to be addressed. And can be a hormonal issue, it could be a neurological issue, it could be a doggy psychiatric issue needing a veterinary behaviorist. And while we as dog behavior consultants do not diagnose that, it is often our role to sound the alarm bell and say, wait a minute, there's something going on here with this fur kid, and there's a medical problem that needs to be addressed. This is not something that we can work on behaviorally until the animal is stabilized medically.
And I'm going to jump in right there, because Angie and I talk about this all the time. I mean, you know, we meet a lot, we talk a lot, and this is one of the things we talk about. Because for me, and I'm on my platform right now, so I'm going to apologize in advance. For me, this is the crux of why shock is off the table for me. Because if your behavior change program is not working and you have your mechanics down and your SOPs good, it is because there are neurological problems or hormonal problems or health problems. And just suddenly saying to yourself, well, let's just go one rung higher on that humane hierarchy is absolutely wrong. And I think all too often you know, people don't get the right results with counter conditioning for some of the reasons Angie's going to talk about. So then they use that to justify going up that humane hierarchy, which is why neither Angie or I are particularly big fans of the humane hierarchy. We don't believe we don't believe it's a ladder you climb. We believe it's circular, and that within that circumference of that circle, there are certain things that we can do and use that are ethical and effective, and there are things that fall outside that circle that, as dog behavior consultants, we have no business intervening in, because it becomes part of a veterinary behaviorist protocol. So I wanted just to throw that out there, because
thank you for jumping in with that, Nikki, because it's so heartfelt, and I can't you know, agree with you more. And you know, I recently had a client whose dog was diagnosed with hallucinations by a veterinary behaviorist, and this dog was behaving very aggressively in a specific context, and many people would have wanted to have climbed the ladder. And you know, especially with aggression, it triggers many times fear and aggression in the humans around that dog. And of course, that would have been a completely unfair, inappropriate thing to do to this dog, and it would have very likely made the problem a lot worse. So a final reason why, physical reason why counter conditioning may not work could also be environmental management failure. I talk about that in the article quite extensively. What I mean by that is flooding. Flooding is very insidious, and trainers and dog behavior consultants get very sensitive when you insinuate or suggest that they may be flooding. And the reality is, all of us need to be grateful when somebody suggests that, because that is many times why counter conditioning is not working, because we're accidentally flooding, and it can be extremely tricky to avoid that.
Thanks, Angie. In the article, you also discuss four common reasons, actually, why counter conditioning fails. And the first reason you give is lack of a global safety zone. Can you tell me, what do you mean by lack of a global safety zone?
Absolutely. I would love to tell you. So the lack of a global safety zone is that if the dog that you're designing the behavior modification program for fundamentally does not feel safe in his own home, then the behavior modification protocol is going to fail. And again, that doesn't mean counter conditioning doesn't work. It simply means that you're not addressing issues in the dog's own home. And if the dog can't feel safe at home, it's not reasonable for us to stick him in a car and drive him down the road and expect him to feel safe some other location at, you know, fill in the blank spot. So it's very, very important that dogs' body language is very carefully analyzed so that people can read where their dog is happy. Joy and safety are interconnected. This is another reason why I'm very, very, very motivated to bring joy to dogs and indirectly people's lives, because it's so important for behavior modification. If you don't see a dog smiling in a variety of locations, if they seem shut down, that dog, including in their home, is probably experiencing a lack of global safety zone. And that is a really important thing to modify. And that's where the training starts. That's where the modification starts, in the home. What can we do to help this dog feel safe in their home, in every single room, in every single area of that home? Incredible challenge for some dogs that have a lot of fear issues to make that happen.
So everybody should actually learn more about dog body language, shouldn't they, in order to know whether their dog actually feels safe or not?
Oh my God,
yes,
hold me back, hold me back, hold me back.
And yes, I know Nikki's really into this too, and what Nikki and I both advocate is doing an individual ethogram, evaluating not just understanding dog body language in general, but understanding this specific dog, because there's so many things that can be occurring. There's dogs that have, you know, nerd-like communication, and you have to understand that, you know, when they do a certain body language. It may even be offensive to another dog. It's not their intent. And while that may not matter in terms of the end result, it's an important variable to be aware of. So body language is very, very important.
So if somebody thinks that their dog is lacking a global safety zone, what can they do as a guardian to establish one?
Well, that's a difficult question to answer because it really depends on the dog. You know, everything I do is always customized to that individual dog. So I would begin with looking at the dog's body language in each room, in each area of the room, and finding what part of the home the dog is able to consistently display joy. If that's all parts of the house, well then great, you already have your global safety zone and you're good to go. If the dog's only happy in the closet, in the back corner, and that's the only place he can play, then there's a lot of work to be done. And I love a team approach to behavior modification. So I have a veterinary behaviorist that I work with. Actually, she's also presenting at the summit, Dr. Juarba Diaz. She's absolutely wonderful. I highly recommend her, and I'm so lucky to be able to have her work with clients. I know many dog behavior consultants don't have that, and I'm just incredibly grateful for that. And so many times I refer to her. Of course, there's also vets that have special interests in veterinary behavior. And sometimes, you know, if you can't get a global safety zone and can't get a global safety zone, you really need to look at getting the dog seen by a veterinarian, hopefully a veterinary behaviorist, and seeing if you can get a pharmacological intervention that just springboards you. And it may not be forever. You may not need that. But if the dog is just so scared, you got to break the cycle. You got to find a path to joy.
Okay. A second reason you guessed why counterconditioning fails is lack of a situational safe zone. What is a situational safe zone, and how could it impact counterconditioning?
So the global is, you know, is home, is that's your home base, and fundamentally the dog needs to feel safe there. So the situational is when you leave the home and you go into a specific situation. So, you know, you put your dog in your car and the dog sees another dog and flips out. Well, clearly the dog's not feeling safe in the car. So there is a situational safe zone that is not occurring. That is a big red flag. That dog is not feeling okay in the car. It could be at the dog park, it could be in the vet's office, it could be at dog school, but the concept fundamentally is that you're taking the dog out of a situation where they feel safe and you're putting them in a new situation and the dog loses their ability to feel safe. And of course, a lack of safety is oftentimes what sets us up for the dog to trigger. So, you know, many of us call it trigger stacking, that if you take a dog and they don't have a global safe zone at home, and then you put them at the dog park safe there, you're already trigger stacking because the dog didn't feel safe at home to begin with, so they don't have any resources, they don't have any energy, they don't feel ever like they're charging their batteries. So now you put them in the dog park, and then out of nowhere, the dog explodes and attacks another dog. But the truth is that, no, it was because the dog was exposed to multiple situations that were causing distress and a lack of safety. So when you're working with a dog and they do have the global safe zone at home and you're taking them to another location, it's incredibly important that they do feel safe at that location. Again, you want to have done your homework. You want to really understand this particular dog's body language. You want to be very clear about whether this dog can play. Play is a beautiful indicator of a safe zone. So if you now take this dog and put him in the car, can they play with you in the car? If they can't play with you in the car, clearly they don't feel safe. So now you have to modify the environment somehow. You're either going to take them out of the car and work outside of the car, gradually work your way back into the car, or you're going to modify a variable inside the car, such as covering the window, doing something to help the dog feel comfortable. Because if they can't experience joy, if they can't experience happiness, then counter conditioning is going to fail.
So Angie, I'm just going to jump in again there, because I just want you to talk a bit more about this, because I think one of the things that we see a lot is people, or we hear a lot, we read a lot, is people saying it doesn't work, and then they look at alternative methods, and then you sort of look at a video of the dog that supposedly it's not working on, and we look at the dog and go, well, the dog is really stressed. I mean, of course it's not going to work. The dog's already way over threshold, and I got that word threshold. My God, that could bring out everybody to start talking about that word. Because I don't think a lot of people realize that to start a counter conditioning program, you have to start with a dog that is already feeling relaxed. And even if a dog is, you know, negatively attentive towards the problematic condition stimulus, it's too late. You're done. It's too late. So I think, how does that fall into what you're saying? I mean, what you're talking about is the global safety zone and situational safety zone. But in more succinct language, are we not saying that owners and trainers need to recognize the physical state and emotional state a dog needs to be in terms of understanding? It goes back to the ethogram again, doesn't it? Understanding that particular dog and trying to determine from the operants that we're seeing what its current mental state is.
Yes, I agree with you. And you said an important word. You said relaxed. And what I would like to add to that is relaxed and happy. Because frequently what I see is video of dogs that are glazed. They're in some dissociative state. They're calm. They're not relaxed, and they're certainly not happy. And that's why I'm really trying to bring the emphasis to the emotional state happy. And I ask my clients, when do you see your dog be really happy? And most of my clients can be very clear. They'll say, oh, when he's doing this and that. He's just, his whole body is just incredibly happy, and he enjoys that activity so much. And I say, that is your goal. Our goal is to get your dog that happy when he's near other dogs. Our goal is to get your dog that happy when he's near the UPS guy. So they understand that's our goal. You want to replace fear and anger with ecstatic joy.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, and you know, it goes back, doesn't it, to this same old topic that, oh God, I want to bang my head against the brick wall, is that just understanding canine communication and social behavior and consent testing and understanding what these dogs are communicating to us. Because, I mean, for me, if we don't get that, how can we do anything else? How can we provide a safe and, you know, global or situational safe environment for them? How can we understand? How can we prevent and emphasize dog bite safety? I mean, you know, everyone has been on the show today. This is sort of, it all goes back to the same thing, doesn't it? It's about understanding this canine communication and how we just all need to get so much better at being able to do that and educate other people on how to do that.
Absolutely. And I find it fascinating that many people are not able to distinguish the difference between calm and joy. And that is something I think we really need to close the gap on in our profession. I mean, wouldn't it be nice for the dog to want to be with the baby? You know, yes, that doesn't mean that they have to be on top of each other, that's touching. But there's so many games that you can play to condition a dog to want to be near a baby, to want to look at the baby, to want to interact with the baby safely, that can really shift the relationship right from the start. And then those games can be revisited at every developmental stage of the child to you know, brush up. And the really cool thing is that when you establish what I'm going to call a language with your dog, if you understand how to use consent testing, if you understand how to read your dog's body language, you are creating a language, especially if you include things like the look game. You have an entire language of communicating with your dog. And the really cool thing about that is it's a two-way street. So your dog can tell you, I'm really not comfortable in this environment. And you can immediately get him out of it. And also, the language becomes a process that the dog recognizes, so that when you go to a new environment and you start to initiate the conversation, the dog's like, yeah, okay, it's cool, I'm fine. You know, yeah, thanks for checking in, but I'm all right. So it's it's just such an awesome thing to, and it's something everybody can do. Everybody can talk to their dog and create a system of language where, you know, yes, there's not grammar in it, so some people might disagree with me that it's language, but according to Wikipedia, it's language because it's communication. And so therefore, I'm using that word. But yes, when we establish the global and the situational safe zones, we're creating reinforcement history between us and our dogs, and then you can also call that trust. And that is also an incredibly powerful thing that the dog starts to feel, just as Jen was saying, safe around us, and we're their gateway to safety instead of their...
Right, right. I'm going to throw in a question here, if you don't mind, Louise, because this actually came up on a discussion on Facebook yesterday. Somebody was asking about this article, funnily enough, and I actually tagged Angie in it, and she jumped in a bit later. But during that process, Linda Michaels, I was talking about how fun and play are incompatible with fear and anxiety, and Linda Michaels said, well, that's true in a general sense, but do we have to be careful about in terms of the scale of arousal? So can you talk about that a little bit?
Awesome, yes. I was hoping you would bring that up. This is all about knowing the individual dog again. You have to study this dog. You have to know your dog. So one of my own dogs counter conditions best if I play with him. And he'll do it with food, but if you want the big guns, if you really want to, you know, work your magic, you got to tug with him. That's his number one thing. So a very important thing in counter conditioning is that the reinforcer that's used has to be amazingly powerful. And so you have to understand what's going to be powerful. And you also need to understand when you're using powerful things that they can crank up your dog's arousal level. So you need to know, you have to have a play history. You need to know this dog's levels of play, high, low, medium arousal, all that kind of stuff. You need to know what takes them over the edge and what doesn't, so that you can play in a way that is effective for the situation. So I know that sounds probably complicated, but it just is. I mean, you can't just do something and follow a recipe. There is no recipe. You have to understand that it's all customized and it all depends on the dog. So you need to know that when play occurs in waves, and there's a certain increase in arousal that will occur, and then you can bring it down again. And of course, if you're experienced playing with your dog will begin to self-regulate and will begin to bring it down themselves, because you've done that so many times that they understand that play is followed by relaxation, and then play, and then relaxation, and that these two things are connected. And so I do not see arousal as a fundamental problem, providing the dog that you're working with is properly understood.
And I, you know, that brings up, that's another question, and that's a whole other discussion, is how to play with dogs. I mean, how many different ways you can play with dogs, and that's a whole discussion for another day, I think, but also, yes, also a massive topic.
Yeah, would love to do that one. Yeah.
Okay, well, I'm going to hand you back to Louise. I think Louise has got another question for you.
Absolutely. Well, you've done really well there, girls, because you've answered loads of my questions without me even asking them, so that's great.
Always.
I'd like to change the topic actually slightly away from the article. You definitely helped, Nikki. Thank you very much. Okay, Angie, I'd like to ask you about your role in Dognostics, and also some of the programs that are available through Dognostics Career College.
Yes, I'd love to talk about that. Dognostics Career College is a trade school, and we offer a variety of programs. We offer programs for people who want to do pet sitting. Those are the pet care technician programs. We offer a regular program, an advanced pet care technician program, and we also offer a dog training program, of course, and then we offer a dog behavior program. And Nikki founded Dognostics, and I co-founded it with her, and I have the honor and the privilege of being faculty there, and I really, really enjoy helping shape the future of our training industry. And we work very hard to try to raise the bar and set the highest standards that we possibly can for our students.
That's Angie's way of saying we're very difficult to work with. No, it's not. I'm just joking.
Well, I have to say, personally, I would definitely recommend Dognostics. No, you're not. Yeah, I tell you what, I've done a couple of courses through Dognostics myself, and I have to say, absolutely fantastic courses, and you girls are just great mentors. So, yeah, I'd say to anybody that's looking into doing a course to have a look at Dognostics Career College.
And I'm just going to plug it myself. We've actually got some really
exciting. What do you think, Nikki? Is that good advice?
That wonderful advice. Thank you, Louise. I'll pay you later. We've got some great new things that are going to be rolling out in the next few in the next few months as well. So stay tuned. So are we done and dusted with Angelica?
Well, I could carry on all day, actually. How long do you want me to go on for?
Well, we probably should call it a day. I mean, it's so hard because we always have such great people on the show. It's so hard to keep it to the time. Angie, tell everybody how they can find you. Start with your own business and then the other companies that you're involved with.
Okay, I own Courteous Canine Dog Smith of Tampa. So you can get courteouscanine.com. CourteousCanine.com. You can also get me through dogsmith.com because obviously I'm part of the Dogsmith and I love the Dogsmith. And I'm on Facebook as Angelica Schmitz Steinker. So friend me, I'll be happy to chat with you.
Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you so much. Lou, I think we've got to pretty much wrap it up for the day. Is there anything that you would like to say before I say good night to you and good night from me and good night to everybody?
I'd just like to tell everybody who's coming up on our next show, which will be the first Sunday of September. And we've got Sally who's coming. She's going to be joining us from England to talk about her dog game, Sprinkles. She's also a PPG member who's both a dog trainer and a lecturer. Our next guest on the show will be Jennifer Arnold, and we'll be catching up with Jennifer, who's the founder and executive director of Canine Assistance, which is a non-profit organization which trains and provides service dogs for children and adults with physical disabilities and other special needs. And our final guest on our next show will be Dr. Lynn Honickman, and she'll be joining us from Orlando, so close to you. She's a PPG Special Counsel member, and we will be chatting to Dr. Lynn about how pet dog trainers can best work with their local veterinarians to the benefit of the client, the veterinarian, and the pet dog trainer. So that's what's coming up on our next show, Nikki.
Fabulous, fabulous. So once again, thank you so much to Angelica Steinker, round of applause, and Janice Bradley and Jennifer Shryock. Thank you so much for giving us your most valuable time on this Sunday. I'm sure there's lots of other things that you could, would, should be doing. So thank you, thank you, thank you. And Louise and I look forward to seeing you on the first Sunday of the next month, which will be September. Oh my goodness, September. The first Sunday in September. So thank you, everybody. Good night from me.
First Sunday. Bye. And good night from me.
Bye.
Bye.